in the front. I'm not here next Friday, so you can have Friday and the weekend to finish your paper.
Good in there.
So I'll give you. Start, finish, wherever you are.
I'm glad you thought highly of me though, that's appreciated.
And then after that, we only have our two tests left in here?
Yeah, only.
Don't we have a paper and two papers?
We just have one paper and two tests.
Oh yeah, there'll be daily assignment for Hebrew.
Daily assignments?
No, the book of Hebrew.
Are you serious?
Yes, they're daily. Every time we have a class, we'll have a paper.
Shut up.
It's in the syllabus.
Why are you gonna do it like that?
Okay.
I look forward to it.
It's really in the syllabus, cause I was not.
Yeah.
Okay.
I wish it was at the beginning.
You know, semester's getting easier and easier as you go along, so.
Social rhetorical content.
Not every semester gets harder.
Okay, now, we are in chapter one, and we wanna get to 3A.
Alright, let's do it.
So, would somebody like to open with a word of prayer? Anybody comatose? If not comatose.
I thought Josh saw me.
Oh, did you? Okay, oh, sorry.
Yeah, I thought so.
Heavenly Father, we ask in the name of Son Jesus to lay on this class, Lord God, knowledge that you have intended for us, to write your scriptures on our heart, your words on our heart, so that we can go out and use this to broaden your kingdom. We thank you, Jesus, in your holy and precious name we pray. Amen.
Okay. We left off in chapter one, we hadn't gotten too far. We looked at 3 and 4, which talks about the knowledge gained, personal knowledge gained of Christ at conversion, that relational knowledge is the basis for all godliness. He then went on in 5 to 7, which is where we kinda left off. The fact that for the very reason that we do now have all the resources necessary for a godly life, he says, make every effort to support your faith with goodness, knowledge, self-control, endurance, he lists these virtues. So the thing to note about 5 to 7, it is a virtue list. It is, all these virtues are founded, are based in the faith. That's the first thing in here. And then it's kind of a hodgepodge as to, there doesn't seem to be a real true stepping here. I mean, it's not like you have to be good before you can have knowledge. You have to have knowledge before you can have self-control. But the middle are standard Christian and Greek virtues. And they end with love, that all of this moral effort that is coming out of our relational status with Jesus, all of it ends, it reaches its apex in love. Okay. Sounds very Johanna-ine at that point. So it's based in faith, all these virtues are based in faith, and they culminate in love. And I won't go through each one of the virtues because they are in your commentary where I have spelled them out earlier, previously. I'm not sure I'm lecturing from the notes that from the commentary or the commentary that became the notes that became the commentary. I don't remember the order, but anyways, it's all discussed in there. And 8 and 9 are giving us further reasons why we should do what's in verses 5 through 7. So 8 and 9 give us further support for the virtues. And his reasoning is, if these things are yours, these virtues, and are increasing among you, they keep you from being ineffective and unfruitful in the knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. This goes back to verse, let's see, where is our knowledge of Christ? It's in verse said in verse 3, had everything that we needed for a godly life. Then he talks about the moral effort necessary. And if you put the moral effort in, verse 8 is telling us, you won't be ineffectual in your relationship with Christ. It will have fruit. It will bear fruit. It will be effective. So we're still talking about that relational knowledge, that epigenosis that we talked about earlier. Same word as in verse 3. So you can't just have a relationship with Christ and sit on your fanny. You have to then try and make effort to add these virtues so that you're not unfruitful. You can have knowledge of Christ, personal relationship, and not be fruitful. You're trying to say, no, keep working, keep making the moral efforts. Because salvation is a process. And then in 9, anyone who lacks these things is short-sighted and blind and forgetful of the cleansing of past sins. So he's saying, don't forget about your cleansing of past sins is to encourage you to add these virtues to your life. Okay, let's see what we missed. Therefore, kind of keep building his argument. Therefore, brothers and sisters, be all the more eager to confirm your call and election. If you do this, you will never stumble. There's, again, we need to confirm the call by acting on the call and acting on our relationship with Christ. As he puts it here, this echoes verse 5 again, that all moral effort possible should be expended toward Christian maturity. That is going to repeat itself in 3:14. So, again, more. Oh, I just forgot. And that will culminate at the end of the chapter in 3:14. Let me speed that over right here. Therefore, beloved, while you're waiting for these things, second coming, strive to be found by him at peace without spot or blemish, sinless. Working on these virtues. Well, obviously, if you're beginning a letter with that theme and you're ending a letter with that theme, that's one of his main concerns. And obviously, if the opponents are teaching you that morality is not important because the second coming is not right around the corner, then that's going to be his focus, is morality. Let's see. And 11. In this way, entry into the eternal kingdom of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, will be richly provided. When you enter, we want a grand parade. Oh, look who's here. He's not saying you won't get in the eternal kingdom if you don't strive for these virtues. But you want your entry to be richly provided when you enter the eternal kingdom. Lots of reward for all of your efforts. So you want a rich entrance.
So is God just gonna be like, some people can just go and get nothing, and you're like, yeah, you barely made it.
Yep.
You're wild.
That was true.
I don't think that. I mean, reward is graded.
Reward is graded.
I think it makes sense. You think so?
Some people get more than others, yeah, for sure. And Jesus even says that somebody's going to sit on his right hand. Someone's going to sit on his right hand.
They're like friends. But it's like other people were just his acquaintances.
That would be the top honor, to be on his right hand.
Oh, okay, Jesus.
So somebody's really going to be way up at the top.
Who do you think? You know him?
Who knows? I mean, I would think it'd be someone like Mother Teresa or Billy Graham or, you know, just...
Tad White.
Who do you think can rotate?
You're a God right hand today.
They each get a day, you know? All right. It's
so
Tuesday.
But there is great reward.
You know what I mean?
Now, I think C.S. Lewis, as much as he is not necessarily a great theologian, but very effective in how he presents theology, has that great story about, which I think it's in Mere Morality, where he talks about, what did I say?
Is it the Great Divorce?
There is a book, Mere Morality, but anyway, where he talks about everybody's sort of at a banquet in heaven, and some people are having hot dogs, and some people are having filet mignon, but everybody's thrilled.
Is it the Great Divorce?
I don't remember.
It is. I said that. Like,
is that where it is?
Yes, it's the Great Divorce.
That's a good book.
Go, Becca.
It is.
It's like you give people in hell a chance to come to heaven, and all they do is crab and head back to hell. They don't get it. So, the bus ride to heaven. Okay. Let's see. Yeah. Although, you know, he must make every effort on spiritual life, salvation, all that is needed to grow spiritually, his theological promises remain gifts. They will be richly provided by you. Okay. All right. That's his little sermon. You have everything you need. Here's the vices you need to work on based on your knowledge of Christ.